about what it takes to actually win and make change in our communities and in our state. Walk with me, Lord. We're going to move into our panel. We will be joined this evening by Raymond Jetson with MetroMorphosis, Ms. Alfreda Bester with Southern University Law Center, and Maria Harmon with Step Up Louisiana. And so please welcome, join me in welcoming our panel tonight. You know, you should never moderate when there's a pastor on the panel or giving remarks before you, but I'm going to do my best. But one thing I wanted to share with you before we begin our panel tonight is, you know, is that in the second book of Corinthians, Scripture teaches us that we are to take great pains to do what is right, not only in the eyes of the Lord, but also in the eyes of men and women. And it is this very principle that the folks on our stage today stand behind and fight for every single day. And so again, I will be your moderator tonight. I'm Ashley Shelton with the Power Coalition, and really excited to open this this discussion on voting rights and voter suppression and the moment that we're in right now as a country where, you know, they talked about the 1965 Voting Rights Act, and in 2020, we are fighting for our lives to hold on to the principles of the voting rights of 1965 in 2022. And so we have much work ahead of us. And so I want to go on and open up because I know that Raymond Jetson has to leave us at some point for another engagement. And so I want to open it up to you, Raymond. And, you know, my question for you is that you hail from a family of leaders, much like Reverend Otis Moss III. And as a legislator, faith leader, now a community leader at MetroMorphosis, can you talk to us about your unique perspective? You've seen it from all the different angles. And so can you share for us what are your thoughts on this ongoing fight for voting rights?
Well, thank you so very much. And I don't know. I can only hope that the power of this movie was as real for you as it was for me and for us. It brought back so many memories. As I sit here today, the thing that concerns me the most is I am not certain that enough people realize the seriousness of the moment and just how precarious the situation is. And I firmly believe that the determination of those who would take must be matched by the determination of those who would defend. And as I observe so many things happening across this country and in our own community, I am concerned that we are looking for somebody else to stand up and defend what belongs to us. And if we don't, then the dream that Mr. Moss walked in vain for will unfortunately be lost on our children. These are precarious moments, and it is imperative that each and every one of us give our best effort, join with others to make certain that we plant those trees that others will be able to benefit from, just as we have. I will end my remarks by sharing. I was in a conversation yesterday with a gentleman in Seattle, and he made a comment that haunted me after the call. He said, "I am not certain that we have retained the muscle memory to undertake a movement." And my prayer is that he was wrong, and that that DNA and the DNA of folks like my great uncle, Gus Young, will rise up in us, and our muscle memory will be revived again, and the movement that's necessary will become real.
Thank you so much, Raymond. And at this time, I would like to also bring up our guest speaker today as well to join the panel. Dr. Moss, will you join us? Thank you. Alfreda Bester, my a longtime attorney, state leader, leader at Southern University Law School, Law Center. You and I have had many discussions about voting rights, redistricting, and have been fighting the good fight to educate and engage our communities throughout Louisiana. And so can you share from your perspective, why was it so important for you to engage in the fight around redistricting and the multiple fights throughout your career on voting rights?
Well, let me start first of all, because I would be remiss if I didn't, to say happy birthday to Mr. Marvin Broom. Reverend Moss, this was a little too close for comfort for me. Those of you who know me have heard me say over and over and over ad nauseum that every time the polls open, I am there. Every time the polls open, I am there. And I don't wait until election day. Usually my husband and I are there on the first day of early voting because we don't want to miss that opportunity. Why? Because it's in my DNA. A little bit about me. I grew up in Hattiesburg, Mississippi. Nobody knows that because Louisiana has adopted me. I've been here so long, Mississippi won't have me anymore. My daddy passed away when I was 6 years old, August 1965. Don't y'all start counting. August 1965. The Voting Rights Act was passed August 6, 1965, just after my father passed away. My father was a veteran of the United States Army, but my father was never a full citizen of these United States of America. My father passed away, having never been allowed to cast a vote in Mississippi, where he was born and where he died. So when y'all see me tweeting at 3 o'clock in the morning, me and my daddy are on patrol because it is my responsibility to make sure that everyone has the opportunity to vote. It is my responsibility because the Word of God says that to whom much is given, of them much is required. Not talking just about your finances. It's talking about the abilities, the gifts, the knowledge, the access that He has given you. God has given me much. I will tell you that I am my daddy's wildest dream. This is real for me. I'm the person who gets up on election day and call all my friends and tell them, y'all get up and go. It's time to go. It's time to go. Why? Because nobody is trying to take anything away from you that's not worth anything. You can pass all of the voter suppression bills that you want when you have an election for Congress and 13.7% of Louisianans show up. 13.7. Y'all can count. Subtract that from 100. We have an election that includes judges. And we had an 11.7 9% turnout in East Baton Rouge Parish. If y'all are not ashamed of that, then I'm ashamed of y'all. You don't have the right to not show up. You don't have the right to not show up. Children are depending on you. Mm-hmm. Our elderly are depending on you. The disenfranchised are depending on you. Why do you think that the first thing that they do whenever they arrest somebody and convict them, sometimes unjustly, one of the first things that happens is they take away their right to vote. And even when they get out of jail and when they go to the store, they get taxed just like you. Taxation without representation. If you're not angry about that, well, let's just, y'all just be angry that my daddy fought for this nation and was never allowed to be a full citizen. So yeah, I get up every day, Ashley, and I fight with everything that I have, everything that God has blessed me with, because I know that it's not just because I'm a good person. It's because God has charged me to do it. And I can't not do it. Sometimes I want to not do it, y'all. I don't want to be the one all the time. And I feel like I'm the one all the time. I feel like I'm the one, but I can't not do it. It's just like fire, Pastor. Mm. Shut up in my bones. I don't want to sometimes, but I can't not do it. So I don't know if I answered your question, Ashley, but I want to inspire all of you to understand what is happening around you. People are not just trying to keep you from voting just to keep you from voting. This is where the public policy is made, whether you're going to eat, whether you're going to be housed, whether you're going to be able to feed your children, whether you're going to be able to educate your children, whether your children are going to go to school with heat, whether there's going to be air conditioning in your schools, whether people are, y'all, it matters. Every election matters. And you ought to be there beating down the door every time. Y'all, we don't have the right to stay home.
Yes, thank you so much, Alfreda. And you answered my question. I know what drives you. I know why I can call on you at any time. And we're going to have a panel on whatever needs to be talked about. We're going to educate the public on whatever needs to be, what they need to be educated on. And I often say that, you know, voting is one of the unnamed, you know, social determinants of health. Folks talk about all of the different aspects of the social determinants of health, but I think nothing more than voting is more critical to whether you have access to housing, food, safety in your community, all of the things that government pays for. And so I often say that and certainly agree with you, Alfreda. And thank you so much for sharing your father's story. Maria Harmon. So Maria is the co-founder of Step Up. She is an organizer that hails from Lake Charles and came to Southern University and is now a native daughter of Baton Rouge. Goes home often, but she does live right here in Baton Rouge. And so I know you spend a lot of time connecting people and community back to their vote, their voice, and their power. Can you speak to how voting rights shows up in your organizing when you're with community?
I'm sorry, I missed the last part of your question. I'm sorry.
Oh, no. I just said you spend a lot of time connecting people back to their voice and their power. And so I was just wanting you to share with us, how does voting rights show up in your organizing work when you're engaging with community?
Thank you. Voting is honestly the essential piece that helps to solidify the issues that we advocate for. At Step Up Louisiana, we advocate for education and economic justice. And we hold elected officials accountable by showing up at meetings, speaking on record when it's necessary, but the piece to also credentialize our movement if we go out to vote. That is essential every single time, because all of that advocating, all of that pressure we put, all of it really, it doesn't really amount to anything, essentially, if you're not voting. I hate to say that, but it's the truth. Whenever you do go to speak on record, they ask you your name and they ask for your address. And the reason why they ask these questions is to go and see if you are a chronic voter. That's essentially why they ask that question. They're not just asking questions just to ask them. They are trying to see if you are a credentialed person in the community utilizing your civic right to go out and vote. Because if you're continuously showing up and speaking up on record, they're going to dismiss what you're saying. One thing I can say within the past 10 plus years of organizing is that constituents who have shown up to vote, but also hold people accountable, they are the ones who really are in the thorn of the side of a lot of elected officials who don't like to deal with very vocal and powerful people in the community. And every time that we do turn out to vote in record high numbers, we tend to get a more desirable candidate. For example, in 2019, we had Governor John Bel Edwards run for re-election, and he won that election by the skin of his teeth. And that was the first time that Step Up Louisiana actually participated in a larger coalition in partnership with the Power Coalition. But us alone, in our share of activity in putting out paid canvassers on the doors between Baton Rouge and New Orleans, we were able to knock on over 40,000 doors, Step Up Louisiana alone. Now, think about the amount of other doors that were knocked on by other organizations like Vote and the Power Coalition. All of us had an impact on the result of that election, because who was in the opposition to John Bel Edwards? We had Edward Responde, this person that was trying to, I believe, have a drastic impact on the Constitution. He wanted to also privatize the mess out of public education. I mean, these were a lot of undesirable policies that this guy was trying to push. And, I mean, John Bel Edwards is not a perfect person either, but he is someone, right, that we can definitely hold accountable. That's the piece to this. We're not going to have a perfect politician, but who is the person that we could most hold accountable? And we knew that John Bel Edwards was that person. But to see that in itself, like the amount of people who voted, like in New Orleans, Baton Rouge, Shreveport, those were the primary locations that John Bel Edwards actually won. When you look at the rural areas, even in my hometown in Lake Charles and Calcasieu Parish, John Bel Edwards lost in that area because we didn't have enough of our people turning out to vote. You know, and I actually fussed at my cousins. I was like, y'all saying we won, but you didn't vote. Like, y'all did not show up to vote. I really got on them about that upset because John Bel Edwards did not win in this area. He lost out here. And they were like, what? You know, I'm like, yes, this is true. So the power of us turning out to vote is very essential. It brings all of the advocacy, all of the direct actions of risk and arrest and whatnot to advance our campaigns and fight for change. That all comes in full circle when we turn out to vote.
Thank you. And it's so true. This governor was undeniably elected by Black voters, and it is no secret. It is true. There are receipts, lots and lots of receipts. And so when you think about exactly what Maria said in terms of being able to hold someone accountable, you know, we had a redistricting process, a special session that just ended. We did not pass one map that was legal and met the requirements of Section 2 of the Voting Rights Act. And, you know, the governor vetoed the congressional map, and without the pressure of Black pastors and Black voters and community putting that pressure, saying what they wanted, showing up at the Capitol day after day, we would not have gotten that win. And it's an opportunity for Louisiana that has the second largest Black population in the country, 33% African American, to actually realize a second congressional district, majority-minority district in our state, and it's huge. And so it matters that we can hold folks accountable. And so I'm going to bring in Dr. Moss. And, you know, you're a pastor and a social justice advocate. What do you think is the role of the church as we move forward in preserving and expanding voting rights?
Thank you for that question. There are some who believe that the church should not be involved in politics, which is a peculiar thing to say, especially if you are part of a black church. Mm-hmm. Because the black church, from its founding, when it was an invisible institution, was involved in politics. Politics, the word comes from the word polis, which means the affairs of the city. Mm-hmm. And people of African descent, when they gathered together in what was known as free black space that we call the church, that free black space became the Underground Railroad, the affairs of the city. That free black space became historically black colleges, the affairs of the city. That free black space became a part of the social movement that we know as the anti-lynching movement that Ida B. Wells was a part of. Free black space. The Niagara movement that W.E.B. Du Bois was a part of, free black space. So the space that we know as the church has always been seeking physical freedom and spiritual freedom. And we have to be involved in the development and transformation of the city, the county, the parish, the state, the nation, and the world. Otherwise, we are only doing a 50% gospel work because we're not working on transforming people's environment. Let me add this. In the early church, when I speak of the early church, after the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ, what we know as the church movement in Rome, you had Christians who were crucified. Now, conservative scholars will say, well, they were just because they served Jesus. That's why they were, yeah, that's part of it. But one of the reasons was the church used to hold money in common in order to assist orphans, widows, and the poor. And the Roman government was saying, we want some of that money. And the church said, no, this is for the orphans, the widows, and the poor. And they crucified people, publicly humiliated them, because the people they were serving, the Roman government, wanted them to be indentured servants. And the church said, no, these are children of God. So you had a fight between the early church and the Roman government, because it was a revolutionary force that was transforming people's hearts, minds, and bodies. That's the legacy of the church. I'm sorry to say, it's not white evangelicalism. That is the legacy of the church.
Absolutely a word, and I think that, you know, I talk all the time, and all of us that work in partnership all the time, we talk about the fact that we can't do this work by ourselves. Like, this is about trusted community leaders, and when I think about that term, I think about the helpers, our pastors, you know, our legal attorneys, I think about our nonprofit leaders. And so, Raymond, I know you have to leave shortly, and so I'm going to ask you one of our last questions of the night, and it is, you know, you are now leading MetroMorphosis, and the Power Coalition gets to work with you on voting rights issues all the time. And so tell me, you know, what are you excited about, and what do you feel are the challenges as we look at this moment?
Well, we oftentimes talk about our task being that of transforming urban communities from within, and recognizing that the resources that are required to transform our communities cannot be imported. That we must first recognize the assets that are there and that are present. And one of the most important resources that are present is our voice and our self-destiny and our ability to assert our will and to be active in the activities and the affairs of the state. And so a critical element of our work is mobilizing people to vote, to express their will, to make certain that their voices are heard. I have offered on a number of occasions that he who does not participate forfeits all right to raise hell. And so it is imperative that our people recognize that the destiny of our community is tied to the voice that we give, not just to our needs or what we want, but what is right, what is just, and what our communities deserve because we matter. But we have to assert the fact that we have expectations for ourselves. And so we look to build partnerships with folks like the Power Coalition and many of the folks who are in this room, because this is not a Lone Ranger moment. We are inextricably bound to one another, and it is imperative that we work together, which is why we are excited about working with Power Coalition and Step Up and others in raising the voice of the people who live in inner city communities in Baton Rouge.
Thank you. Dr. Moss, I'm gonna let you close us out. And if you could talk to us about what are the most critical opportunities and challenges as we fight this fight on voting rights in this moment.
I think building relationships intergenerationally is critical. To recognize that the elder generation must pass on stories, but not try to take over the organization. That's key, number one. The younger generation that has the, well, let me put it this way. I call it a Mary Elizabeth work, because Mary was a young sister who, in her belly, she was about to birth something amazingly powerful. But Elizabeth was the elder who was sharing with Mary, but she was real clear. I can't birth this for you, but I will be the midwife to assist you. And when two powerful generations come together, you can always turn the world upside down, or in the words of Sojourner Truth, you can turn it right side up. And that's what, I think that's one of the most critical pieces is building that intergenerational piece. The second piece is recognizing the power of the mic. One of my favorite hip hop artists is a person by the name of Nas. He has he had a song called One Mic. Come on now. One mic can change the world. And we are in a moment where we have the mic. Where we can have, we don't need ABC, NBC, CBS, Fox to determine what our voice is gonna be. All we have to do is we can create a Harmon YouTube channel that will break everything down that we can then share and then can reach a million people, and we don't even need to have someone else filter. So we've got to be able to educate ourselves to become the new communicators and hold on to the mic that we have. So intergenerational, communication, and then the other thing to recognize that this is a spiritual fight. It is a spiritual fight. That we're not just fighting against flesh and blood, but against principalities. This is a spiritual fight. And guess what? We ain't new to the fight. There have been there's a cloud of witnesses that are surrounding us that want us to fight on. I'm reminded when my wife graduated from Spelman, Maya Angelou was the commencement speaker. She said something I will never forget as she told the graduating class at Spelman. She said, I say to you, my sisters, I say to each of you, when you step into the classroom, when you step into that interview, when you step into that medical college, no, you ain't going there by yourself. Hello. Said, to your right, you got Ida B. Wells whispering in your ear. To your left, Sojourner Truth is trying to tell you, you are a woman. Right behind you is Fannie Lou Hamer. And in front of you, you need to look into the eyes of your grandmama who already laid the foundation and prayed for you to be in that space. You got a cloud of witnesses around you. And when you know that you are never stepping into any place alone, then you will be truly the wildest dreams and the most magnificent prayers of your ancestors.
So Ashton said I could have 1 minute.
Yeah, 1 second. Look, the mayor's on the way up.
Amen. I do want to stress one thing that Pastor Moss said, intergenerational. Okay, so I've been a lawyer for 20 years. I was a Sunday school teacher for 12 years, and I was raised in Sunday school, y'all. In Hattiesburg, Mississippi, you went to Sunday school every morning. Every Sunday. But there's a word. Bring them up in the way that they should go. And when they are old, they will not depart from it. When you go to vote, take your children with you. Teach them how to press those buttons. And when they move away from Louisiana to Philadelphia, like my kid did, still not happy about that. But he votes. He votes in every election, no matter how long he has to stand in the line, no matter where he has to go to do it. Bring them up in the way that they should go, and when they are old, they won't depart from it.
Beautifully said. Will you join me in thanking our panel tonight? Beautiful words. Our mayor's going to come up and close us out, but thank you so much for your generous words, your stories, your passions, and really appreciate what you shared. The piece around strongholds, you know, Reverend Jennifer will know this. We've been talking about strongholds and the prayers that are necessary if we're going to break through this fight on voting rights. And it's the prayers that I've been saying. It's the scriptures I've memorized, and I say it every day. And even with this win on the congressional map, folks thought it wouldn't be possible. And I just said, well, God still sits on the throne every day, so I'm not going to worry about it. So thank you all for your generous words and your generous spirit tonight, and I welcome up the mayor to give closing remarks.
Thank you so much, Ashley. Let's celebrate Ashley Shelton, who does remarkable work in our community. And let's celebrate our panelists tonight. Wasn't this a rich conversation? Didn't it feed your soul? But more importantly, aren't you motivated to be an ambassador on this issue? You know, I didn't say this when I first came out because I was so ready to hear Dr. Moss, but one of the reasons I pursued inviting Dr. Moss here, and thank you to all of our panelists, you added so much value to this conversation, is because I don't know if that was earlier this year when we were in Denver. Time always just, you know. Earlier this year, I was in Denver with a group of African-American mayors, and the focus was on this issue of voting rights and what was taking place around the country with voter suppression. Now, I will tell you, your mayor, for me, it's no place like Baton Rouge and no place like home. So I don't go to every conference I'm invited to. I don't go to every place I'm invited to, and I am invited to a lot of conversations and a lot of conferences and meetings. But I felt impressed and compelled to go to this one. And as I sat there in the audience and heard Reverend Moss and saw this video, I could not hold back the tears. Because, Reverend Moss, I remember growing up in Chicago with my dad, who was born in 1903 in Louisiana, emphasized that there was never any excuse for not voting. I remember when Martin Luther King came to Liberty Baptist Church when I was a child in Chicago, one of those witnesses that is watching us now. And I remember a woman of the movement by the name of Mamie Till Mobley, who taught third grade at my elementary school, Carter Elementary School, when I grew up. And when I heard you speak, all of those instances start coming back to my mind. But more importantly, the call to lead this city in what is right and what we should be doing and what we should be, what should be important to us, just came to the forefront of my mind. And while we get so bogged down in the day-to-day activities of what's going on, we miss some critical issues that we need to be, we need to have voice to and give voice to. And so I was determined that I was going to have Reverend Moss here to lead this discussion. And it must have been a God thing because he was able to do it. Now, you know he is in demand, and he probably could have said, it doesn't work with my schedule. But when I saw him in Denver, I shared with him. I said, I want to get you to Baton Rouge. And he said, whatever I can do, I will help you. And so thank you so much, Reverend Moss, for coming here tonight. I really believe that this has been a transformative moment for everyone who is here. And I believe this moment will resonate throughout our community. I want to also give thanks to the Martin Luther King Jr. Committee. If you were on that committee, please stand because you've really helped move things forward. If you've been on the committee, stand up. I see. Thank you all so much for what you've contributed. And talk about that intergenerational connection. You know, I love that song that's by India Arie when she says, when young people talk to old people and old people talk to young people, it makes us better people. And, you know, I can't hide it. I am a baby boomer. And so I am surrounded by millennials and young people who add so much value to my life professionally, personally, and who helped me lead this city. So to all of my team, if you're part of the Broome administration, raise your hand. Thank you all so much. And so this will be just the beginning of many other conversations that we will have. Thank you to all our elected officials who are here. Raise your hand. All our faith-based leaders who are here, raise your hand. And people who make up the fabric of this community, I appreciate each and every one of you, name by name, person by person. And of course, now, Attorney Bester, you kind of took away my thunder a little bit. You know, Marvin Broome is my husband, and I was going to tell him happy birthday. I love you, Marvin Broome, and happy birthday. And Dr. Moss, if you would join me up here for 1 minute. So you won't forget your experience here in Baton Rouge. We want to present you with this memento of our Walking in Legacy event in appreciation of our Dialogue 2022. On voting rights and voter suppression. Thank you so much for adding value to our community. And so stay in tune with what we do in our office, in our administration. Thank you all for all of you, all what you do, because each and every one of you add value to our community and your sphere of influence. And please go out and be safe and enjoy the rest of your weekend. Thank you so much. Go vote, yes. Go vote. Look, I would be remiss. We have an election going on right now. Early voting is taking place. Please go vote and take someone with you. Encourage, motivate, and get someone with you. Thank you so much.
Take me under, I know. Imagine. Imagine smoking weed in the street without cops harassing. Imagine going to court with no trap. Lifestyle cruising blue behind my waters. No welfare supporters. More conscious of the way we raise our daughters. Days are shorter, nights are colder. Feeling like life is over. These snakes strike like a cobra. The world's hot, my